Thank you everyone for coming to my presentation. My name is José Manuel Ortega. I come from Spain. And well, this presentation is a little introduction to web scraping tools that we can find in Pyquery and Scrapy and go depth, in particular in Asyncio, how we can build our crawlers, our programs for web scraping in Python. This presentation will be available in my speaker deck space. In my speaker deck space, you can find another presentation related with specific tools in security with Python. The last one I was made was using tools for security auditing. I was another for ethical hacking with Python tools, and another for Python for web developers. This tool is a complement that I was made in this year in a specific event by data in Spain. And well, I will try to complement in this presentation what I will talk in this tool. All examples I will show in this presentation will be available in my GitHub repository, in my personal GitHub repository. And well, all examples, well, the asyncio examples, you need Python 3, because asyncio is only supports Python 3. And other examples that we can see, like BeautifulSoup or Pyquery, you can execute with Python 2, with Python 2 also. Well, this is the main points I will talk. I will make a little introduction to web scraping Python tools. Later, I will try to compare the request module with versus aiohttp. aiohttp is another module that we can use for making requests and integrates better with asyncio. Later, we will see an example. The next point, I will make a little introduction to asyncio, what are the main features. Later, we will see how we can do our own client survey with asyncio. And in the last point, we'll try to show samples on how we can build a web crawling. And finally, alternatives to asyncio that we can find in Python. Where we are talking about web scraping, the web is bigger and there are a lot of services. And the idea with web scraping is that we want to extract data from web page automatically. We need to go to a process for extracting the data that provides web service and HTML pages and so on. And basically what we have to do is extract the data and for processing for save this data and processing this data later. We can save this information in database, and export the data in JSON, CSV format, and so on. The main tools that we have in Pyquery ecosystem are these. Requests are one of the most used for testing, web service. BeautifulSoup is very useful for parsing the data. It's like a parser, like we will see an example. And other of the tools that we can find are Pyquery and Web Scraping. These two tools are like BeautifulSoup, are parsers for HTML pages. And one of the tools more interesting is Scrapy. Scrapy is more than a library; it's a full framework because you can build your own crawlers, spiders, and have a lot of tools for this topic. Another interesting tool, if we want to go deep for web scraping, for example, if we want to functional testing and scraping with JavaScript, we can use these tools, Mechanized, RoboBrowser, and Selenium. We can use these tools in conjunction with PhantomJS for web scraping in JavaScript and extracting data from specific selectors that we can use in JavaScript. Well, as I commented before, the request is one of the main use for this topic. We can with the request. Basically, we can do the request over testing a web service, a REST API. But the problem basically is that it's not asynchronous. That is to say, when you make a request with this library, you have to the main thread is blocked until the response is returned. Later, we will see this in more details. This is the main steps for web scraping with Python. The first step is obviously download the web page with HTTP module. We can use request. We can use relib, or we can use aiohttp for making the request. Later, in a second step, the idea is parse the page with a parser. We can use BeautifulSoup or specific parsers like XML, HTML5, and so on. In the third step, we have to select the elements that we want to extract. We can use regular expressions, XPath, or these Excel selectors. And in the fourth step, if we want to store the results in a database, in a CSV or JSON format, we can do this. Well, the BeautifulSoup supports Python 2 and Python 3 for the basic tags for HTML parser. From HTML page is useful. And for using BeautifulSoup, basically what we can do is construct the BeautifulSoup object, parsing as parameter the HTML doc, and in second parameter we pass the parser that we can to use. In this case, we can use the HTML parser or the XML. BeautifulSoup, the main advantage is that it provides methods for testing and obtain the links, for example, of the page in an easy way. For example, with the find all method and parsing as parameter the link of we want to extract, we can do this in an easy way. For example, if we want to extract the externals and internal links with BeautifulSoup, is very easy. If we want to obtain internal links, basically what we want to do is find all links that begin with a slash. And for retrieve external links, we can find all links that start with HTTP or www that not contain the current URL. In easy way, we can obtain this information. This is an example where we are extracting the external links for Python site. And we can see that external links go to external domain, and internal links go to pages that are in the same domains that we are testing. This is a more complete sample that we can see that we are using. We are starting the the information about the PyCon conference. And the first that we have to do is select the elements, view what are the elements that we want to analyze. In this case, for extracting information about PyCon conference, we can see that we have a div element, and inside this div element is all information that we want to extract. And basically, we have to do this syntax for extracting the data. And this is the output for this script, where we extract the description, session location, title, track, session time, speaker, and details. The main disadvantage of BeautifulSoup is that it's a little, it's slower than another solutions like LXML or regex regular expression. Is we are using, if we want to use regular expression, the solution is faster than use directly BeautifulSoup. And in this parser's comparison, we can see that with BeautifulSoup, the same task, in this case, we are extracting the title of the page. It took 4 seconds, and with regular expressions, the same operation take 12 microseconds. It's a big difference. Another solution that we have is Pyquery. Pyquery is like a BeautifulSoup, it's a parser, but in this case, for extracting information, we have to use the jQuery syntax. For example, if we want to use to extract from the information about the session of the conference, we have to use the syntax div dot session, and inside this is all information that we want to extract. And this is the more simple and in easy way we can extract all information in a JSON format, and the same input that we have seen before, the simple is the same. Well, we are starting with spiders, clouders. Basically, this is a definition from Wikipedia, but well, it's clearly that a web crawler is an internet boot that automatically browses the World Wide Web. And what it's doing is indexing the content of the websites, and this topic is also used by robots and web crawlers for extracting the information and indexing the information. The most useful tool for developing our spider crawler and crawlers is Scrapy. Scrapy from version 1.1 has support for Python 3 and has a better performance and so on. Scrapy is a tool developed by Scraping Hub. Scraping Hub has a lot of tools developed for this topic. In the main Scrapy page, we can see that it has support for Python 2.7 and 3.3 plus. The main advantages that we have, well, this is the main features that have Scrapy. Scrapy basically internally use a mechanism based on XPath expressions called XPath selectors. And for parsing and extracting the data, it uses the parser LXML. This is the parser LXML normally is more faster than the HTML parser. and for asynchronous operation, internally use twisted. The main advantages with regarding orders tools is faster than mechanized because it's using twisted for asynchronous operations, has a better support for passing, and internally have a better support, for encodings, redirections, and so on. And another interesting future of scrapping is that you can export extract data directly to JSON, XML, and CSV format. The idea is that you can build your own spider or crawler, and with this command, with crawl command, passing specific parameters, we can export all data that the spider is crawling. Regarding concurrency, Scrapy has solutions for concurrency. For example, if we want to make more than 8 requests simultaneously, we can configure the concurrent request per domain in settings configuration in Scrapy. By default, only supports 8. This is the maximum number of concurrent requests in Scrapy, but you can change this value in the settings configuration. Well, until this point, I will try to comment the main problems that we have with currency. Well, we try to resolve this problem. We have a different approach, different solutions. We can use multiple processing. We can use multiple threading. We can also separate distribute machines, creating a cluster, for example, or the solution that for me is the better is using asynchronous programming, the event loop. The asynchronous programming is based that with only one thread, we can make various requests simultaneously. The idea is that we have the event loop. Later we will see in more details what is the event loop. But well, the idea is this. We go back and we are talking about requests. I have mentioned that requests have the main problem of requests is that it's blocking the main thread. And well, if we want to asynchronous request, the request is limiting this situation. And we need, and if we want to more than one request at the same time, we need to launch one more thread. We need one thread for each request if we want no blocking operation. What are the thread problems? Well, the main thread problems are that it's getting overhead. The stack size that is difficult to solution, the context change, and the synchronization between threads is very difficult for when you are programming with threads. This problem is very difficult to resolve. Well, the solution obviously is not use threads. The solution is only one thread plus the event loop. This is what it does asyncio. With asyncio, we have new concepts. We have the event loop, obviously, the main concept is the event loop, and we have other concepts like async, wait, futures, coroutines, tags, and executors. These are new concepts introduced where we are working with asyncio. Another event loops implementations that we find in Python. The main that will go in the test is asyncio, but we have another like tornado, twisted, that is used by Scrapy, and gevent. This is the another implementations of the event loop. Well, this is the finitation. Now I'm introducing to asyncio. Asyncio basically what is provide is an event loop for writing and concurrent code using coroutines, multiplexing IO access over sockets and other resources. Asyncio is you can use asyncio with from Python 3.3. Is very useful for from asynchronous operations. Internally, is use sockets for no blocking approach. All requests are executed in one thread. And for making the requests, we can use aiohttp because it's integrated very well with the tool. Asyncio also has interoperated with other frameworks. Can be interoperated with Twisted, Tornado, gevent, and at low level, Asyncio use selectors and UCP for threading, for obtain the asynchronous request. Well, this is the first example that we are going to see. In this case, we are comparing the request with HTTP. We request for making a request only with only one line of code, and with if we want to use HTTP, we need to more code for this situation. In this case, I am using the Python 3.5, and for example, for making the asynchronous request, we are using the client session of aiohttp, and at this point, we open the asynchronous context of the request. And basically, what we have to do, we are doing is obtaining the request. Well, for obtaining more information about event loop allow us to write asynchronous code using callbacks or coroutines. Now we will see what are coroutines. And the idea is that we have an event loop running until all talks schedule are complete. Basically, for starting an event loop, we need to call the getEventLoop method for an asyncio, and for launch coroutines or attacks over the event loop, we have two methods, the run until complete and the run forever. The run anti-complete, basically what is that is executing the tags, the coroutines, in the event loop until all tags are complete. And the run forever is like a infinite loop, basically controlled by the user. This is the first example. If we want to start in the event loop, basically what we have to do is calling the get event loop with the run anti complete. We pass as parameter another function. This function is now I will see that this function is a coroutine that makes something. A specific task, whatever we need in our logic, in our business logic, and will the coroutine finish? It returns the control to the event loop, to the main event loop. At this point, we are introducing coroutines. The coroutines basically are the functions that now we will see that there are different annotations for defining these coroutines. Are functions that allow for multitasking. Basically, I like functions, but they can be suspend or resume at certain points in the code. For writing coroutines, we have two syntax types. For 3.4, we have the decorator, a single IO coroutine. And with this syntax, we have to use for calling our asynchronous code is execute with the yield from keywords. And with the 3.5 syntax, in this case, we can use the async keyword. The async IO syntax for 3.5 is we can use the async with the async keyword and the await. Instead of use yield from, we can use the await keyword from making the asynchronous call. Coroutines in event loop. This is another example. In this case, we have the get page coroutine that we pass as parameter the URL, and the with aiohttp module we make the request in a synchronous way, and we wait the result of this coroutine until complete this task. Another way of making requests in event loop are these. With these two methods are equivalents. The first is making the asynchronous call with the request module. In this case, we have to use the run in executor method from the loop. And the second method is the same. The two methods are equivalent. In the second method, we are using the HTTP module with the client session, open the session with the URL and obtain the response. Another of the concepts that are mandatory to know are tags. Tags, basically, what allow is encapsulate the calls that we made to coroutines. It's another concept that we have to know for understanding completely the async IO management. And when a coroutine is wrapped in a tag, it connects the tags to the event loop. Basically, tags and coroutines are related with the event loop for executing the tags asynchronously. The tags, basically, what are doing is executing in the main thread, and this execution apparently is the tags are in are execution in parallel, but what they are doing is that execution is that the tags are executing in the timeline of the event loop in different periods. In the first start, the task one, after the task two, and the tasks are intercalating the execution time in the event loop. Well, this is another sample. In this case, we are calculating the factorial of a number, and we are creating a task for calculating the factorial of 10, of 5, of 2, and 1. And we define a coroutine factorial, we pass a number, and this return this function obtain the factorial of the number. And in this sample, we are using another method that we can use is asyncio.gather. This method, what is that internally is executing the tags, and until all tags are not finished. This devil loop is constantly review is the of all the all tags are finished or not. This is the execution of the previous script, and basically what are doing is calculating the factorial, intercalating the calls to the coroutine. Another of the concepts that we have to introduce is futures. Futures is another concept for what allows is manage to manage an object future in asyncio. We have to use this object. The idea is similar to concurrent futures that we can find in Python 3. The futures basically is a class that the behavior of this class is like a promise. If you know the concept of the promise, and or in JavaScript, for example, is very used this concept for calling making the request and waiting and defining a callback for this for returning the result of the request. And basically what is that a future is returning the result where they are available. And once it receives the results, it will pass them to the callbacks register for this request. Well, this is an example where we are extracting the. We want to make a request to different sites of the python.org domain. We define the URL, the sites. In an array, and the loop starting the loop, we use the same function get event loop, and in this case we are using the ensure future. We can pass as parameter the coroutine. The coroutine make the request over all the sites defined in the array sites, and with the HTTP with client session, we obtain the information about the URL. In this case, we are obtaining the response of the body response in the future object for returning this information to the main. To the event loop. Well, semaphores are very useful for adding synchronization to the requests. Sometimes, when we are making a lot of requests in a specific site, the server can limit our request and ban it from making the request, and from limiting this the number of concurrent requests, we can use this this method for this store. In this case, we are using the semaphore for limiting the concurrent requests. And the argument indicates the number of simultaneous requests that we want to allow. For integrating this in our asynchronous code, we can use the with object. The with object contains the execution context of the program, and we can integrate this in our asynchronous code with this object. Well, with AsyncIO also we can build our own client server in a synchronous way. With AsyncIO, it has the start server method for creating our own server and handle connection from remote clients. And for creating the clients, we have the open connection that internally we have to pass as parameter the host and the port, and internally we can make the request to the between the server and the client and passing message. And so on. When at this point I will try to make how we can do our own crawlers with AsyncIO. This is the most simple. We start in the event loop, and we want to do is obtain the content of a specific URL using the HTTP.get method. And basically what is that is obtain the response and print the response of the site in this case. For more advanced we want to more advanced tags in this aspect. We can use coroutines for go deep in this task. For if we want to make our own web crawler for sending asynchronous requests to all the links and extracting the links of a page, another response to a kiwi and processes as we go, we can use coroutines in three ways. We can use the method as complete. We are processing the results as they come. Also, we can use the gather method that has seen before. This method it will call only once all the tasks are finished, and also we can use the ensure future. In the case of AsyncIO as complete, this is the code, the more basic code that we can use for this task. In this case, we are declaring a coroutine, process results as coming. And what we are doing in this coroutine is making the calling the get URL coroutine for each URL defined in the array. And for obtaining the response, we are using as complete method from AsyncIO, and we pass as parameter the coroutines array. And in this way, in an easy way, we can process all the URLs that we want to extract information, links, and so on. This is the execution of the script, where we can see that when all tasks are finished, it returns a task object. A task object internally has the coroutines that we have called and the result of the coroutine. In this case, it returns the response of the HTML. In this case, we are returning the body of the response. Another way for making requests is using the asyncio dot gather. With this method, we pass as parameter the coroutines, the array, and in a same way we can obtain this information. This is the documentation on the official documentation from Python. That what gather does is return a future aggregating result from the given routine object or futures. And another way from doing the same task is using the ensure future. The main difference with the gather method that we have seen before is that in this case, ensure future, you can pass a coroutine or a list of coroutine. And ensure future, what is that? Is that it returns a task. And with this task, internally, the process is the same that we have seen before with the gather method. This is the execution that we have, that we can see that we are extracting links from GitHub, and we obtain the results in an easy way. Well, another of the tasks that we can do with asyncio is, for example, if we want to download a web page, an empty web page or an image or a PDF or a document, we can use, for example, this in a classical way. We can use the urlib request for this task over in a same way, but we are using requests. We are not using aiohttp or asyncio. In this case, we are using classical requests for obtain this file. If we want to that this program go faster, we can build a specific coroutine called getPartialContent that in this coroutine we pass as parameter the URL and the parts. The parts are the number of the requests that we can make in an asynchronous way. And basically what is that is this coroutine is making requests in parallel and sending the requests in partial headers. With the header information, we obtain the number of parts that we want to, that we need to process, and we can see that the results, if we are comparing with the other example, with the download coroutine, using the URL requests, we download a file, a PDF file, in 20 seconds, and with the second program that provides partial content over sending header information, we download the same file in 5 seconds. It's very useful for obtaining rapidly this information. If we want to extract in list, for example, with a asyncio, well, the same coroutines that have seen before, we can apply these coroutines over specific regular expression. For example, if we want to extract link, we have a classical regular expression, and we can apply these regular expressions over the content that we are extracting. In this case, we are defining the coroutine process as result coming. We need to process three URLs: python.org, google.com, and github.com. And for extracting this information, the links of this page, we can use in easy way regular expressions for this task. Also, we can use BeautifulSoup in the same way. Instead of using a regular expression, we can use the BeautifulSoup method and parser, and we can use the HTML parser or the XML parser, and extracting the links with the final method passing the parameter from obtaining the links. Well, we try to compare the execution of this script with BeautifulSoup. We obtain this information in 3.9, and with regular expressions, we obtain less time in 3.3. Go faster, but not much, but well, it's faster. Alternatives to asyncio that we can found in Python ecosystem, we can use from this task, from web crawling, are very useful, this module. For example, thread pool executor that equals create a pool of threads. The process pool executors creates a for multiprocessing. And parallel Python is another of the solutions that provides Python for this kind of problems. In the case of Python, there are two ways for resolving these solutions. We can use the SMP symmetric multiprocessing architecture with multiple cores in the same machine. And the other solution is use the distribute tags in multiple machines, creating a cluster of machines, and so on. In this example, we can see that we are extracted for process pool executor. This module provides a specific method for obtain the number of CPUs of the machine, and with this number of CPUs, we can process the crawler, starting the crawling links in an easy way. Like we have seen before, we have the concurrent future process pool executors. We obtain a number of CPUs, and we obtain the tags, the future tags for crawling this information. And well, this is the last slide. These are finally as the reference from the main tools that I comment. And these are the main tools that we can find. These are the main books that we can find. These tools are specific for web scrapping. In these tools are commenting the BeautifulSoup, Scrapy, Pyquery, and so on. And in these two books are specific for asynchronous programming, parallel programming, and go details with asyncio, thread pool executors, and so on. And that's all. Thank you.